So the word intuition is used as the standard English translation of the German word Anschauung. And Anschauung is a fairly fine word for what we are. Schauen means to see, and Anschauung means that there's something you are looking at. But intuition is very often used in English as something that you have some vague notion of. You know, I have an intuition, but I don't really quite understand it, or something like that. And that's not at all this. This is just a word for something that is very much like perception when you think of physical objects. I think coming from other parts of philosophy, perception would be the kind of thing you've heard of that is very close to intuition. But Husserl says that there is something very parallel to perception, and that's the method by which we experience, for example, mathematical objects, that general objects in general are what they call eidos, or essence. And again, these pictures that you remember that instantiated essences. So what is typical of these things is that they are not tied down to one particular physical object, that you could have them repeated again and again on different physical objects. But if you have a physical object, then that's one thing, and that's different from all other physical objects. So these are general features of physical objects, and these are just examples that are often discussed in mathematics. But redness, for example, is an eidos. So you could, when you are focusing on redness, then it doesn't matter which physical object you have in front of you. As long as it's red, it's fine. So, and just interrupt and ask if there's something that is unclear, because this is what we talked about earlier. And now I drew something on the board last time, and now I made slides of it, and I talked about the eidetic reduction. That is when we start out from perceiving a physical object, but start instead focusing on some general feature of that object. And there could be, each object will instantiate a large number of general features. And a general feature can be instantiated with a large number of physical objects. So that an eidos is then a general property of a thing, like this. And the eidetic reduction is then this procedure where you change your point of view. Instead of focusing on the individual object, you focus on the shape or the general feature of it. And then Bernard Bolzano, whom I mentioned earlier, who is one of my favorites in philosophy, he introduced something called a method of variation that we can use when we are performing eidetic reduction. We want to focus on one feature, for example, triangularity. And then we will try to vary the examples and look at various triangles. And then we try to find out what is characteristic of triangularity. Why is it that we would call some objects triangles or triangular and others not? And this is very important for some notions that are not as obvious as the notion of triangularity. One example that Bolzano was very concerned with is the notion of continuity in mathematics. That's a notion that turns out to be much harder to get clear about than people had thought. Normally, you think of a continuous function, for example, as one whose graph you can draw without lifting the pen from the pencil. And Bolzano made some important discoveries about the notion of continuity. They're still among the big insights in mathematics, and they arrived at them very much by thinking of examples that illustrated continuity. And then he tried to change the examples and ask, is that still continuous, and so on. And by that method of variation, he found a continuous function which is nowhere differentiable. That is, you could think of a line that you can draw without lifting the, or a figure you can draw without lifting the pencil on the paper, and which has no tangent in any point. So it's one of the, you heard of chaos and of the very beautiful curves that you can have in connection with chaos. His function was the first instance that anybody constructed of that kind of a curve. So that it's historical, and it was around 1830. And he used a method of variation, which I think we often will use ourselves without thinking much about it, that we try to get clear about the notion, and then we think about various examples, and vary the examples in many different ways, and see how far can we go in the variation without it ceasing to be an object of that kind. Pascal used something a little bit similar in order to see quickly whether some hypothesis was true. You have, when you work in mathematics, for example, you might have a guess that it might be something that seems like a theorem, but you haven't found a proof for it. And then Pascal very quickly checked it by drawing it to the extremes. What happens if that variable gets almost infinite? And what happens if that gets infinite? And then often you could see immediately, then things go wrong. So that cannot be. But as long as you stayed in the normal realm, your intuition seemed to make that valid. So that was, again, varying the examples and going then to the extremes. And the eidetic deduction is simply a change of view. You can be exactly in the same position. People around you cannot know whether you are considering a physical object or some feature, general feature, instantiated by that physical object. And then we got the transcendental reduction. You see, when we read Husserl, there are three kinds of reduction he talks about. And many, even textbooks on Husserl, get these things mixed up. But the other one, the second one, he calls the transcendental reduction. And that is what is particular for phenomenology, because in normal life, we are concerned with the objects out there in the world. But in phenomenology, we study the acts through which we experience these objects. So now we are studying, what exactly are my anticipations now? What else? Is it an act of dreaming? Is it an act of perception? Is it an act of imagining, and so on? So we can try to focus on the act and not worry about the object. But that is a rather unnatural attitude. Husserl calls the normal one the natural attitude. But when we perform the transcendental reduction, we are focusing on the structures of our own consciousness. And these entities he calls the transcendental entities. So the word transcendental means that it's something that is very important for our experience, but which we're not normally aware of. It's only when phenomenologists came along, Husserl, that people started to think much more about the way in which we structure the world than just about the world itself. So we are much more concerned about how consciousness works than about the objects. But of course in other sciences we are concerned about the objects. In geography we are certainly concerned about all these islands and so on around. And even in mathematics we are concerned with the triangles, with the objects and so on, but with the idas of them, but still these are the objects. But the transcendental reduction is simply a focus on our own consciousness, the structure of our own consciousness. And there are two words that I mentioned last time, which is important to keep separate. I mean, made both of the literature on it, and I did mention translations of Sartre in particular, that the translators haven't known it, and they go back and forth. I think it's just a matter of what sounds best. But what is transcendental is what is focusing on our own consciousness. But what is transcendent is that which has a richness to it that cannot be exhausted. And that's the case with pretty much everything we experience, the objects out in the world, this chair is transcendent, because when you look at it and think about it, there are lots of features about the chair that you are aware of, but there will always be much, much more that you are not aware of and even thought of. And that is also something that Husserl stresses, that there's so much going on which is not, you're not conscious of. That's the element that Freud took over from Brentano, and that Husserl took over from Brentano, that objects are transcendent. They are, have this inexhaustible richness. So I hope you see the difference between something being transcendent and something being transcendental. Because anything can be transcendent, whether it's an object out there, maybe things in our own consciousness have a lot of things we never thought of and so on, so they are transcendent. But that which is transcendental, that is that which contributes to the structuring of our world, so that's in our consciousness. And then I drew that diagram, that was the last thing we did last time. I said that since we can have two reflections, we can have these four possibilities. And now I drew the reflections with the arrows elsewhere. So we start out in our natural attitude with the objects in the world, physical objects, physical things. And that is, according to Husserl, the realm of natural science. In natural science, as well as in our daily lives, we are concerned with the physical objects in the world around us, study them. But then we could be, as mathematicians are, we can be interested in some general features of those objects that can be repeated from object to object, like triangularity. Then we perform the eidetic reduction. And that means that we are now studying the eidos rather than the physical object themselves. But we have also the possibility of performing a transcendental reduction. Then we focus on the structures of the acts that are directed towards this kind of object. So we go across, study the noema, the noesis, the hyle, and all these elements that we have talked about in that arrow that I drew. And when we are focusing on the noemata of acts directed towards physical objects, then Husserl says we are doing metaphysics. And he doesn't say much about that. But because what interests him would be this quadrant. And that's where you have phenomenology. And that would be the study of the structuring of the general features of the world. Okay, on this side you have the structuring, and here you have the objects that are experienced through that structuring. So phenomenology then requires you to do both reductions, both the eidetic and the transcendental. So now we have all three reductions in place. The phenomenological is the composite one, an eidetic and a transcendental. And in the different writings by Husserl, these two component reductions are sometimes occurring in one order, sometimes in another. So therefore, it doesn't really matter whether you start with a transcendental reduction and then go on to the eidetic one, or start with an eidetic and then go on to the transcendental. But most of the time, Husserl starts with the eidetic. Most examples he gives, he goes from a physical object to some general feature of that object, and then he goes from that general feature to the way in which we structure that general feature. So that so this is really all that he's interested in. But one should think that although it hardly says anything about metaphysics, one could think that he could have really said that phenomenology includes the study of the noemata of all kinds of acts, not just directed towards the physical objects, towards the general features. But at least this is how he uses the terms. And what is clear is that although he says that he's doing phenomenology, I think what he's doing is really, in general, to stay for the transcendental reduction. That's the important thing, to get at the way in which we structure reality. And then Husserl was, of course, so interested in mathematics because he had this very big background in it. So he is mostly interested in that part where you also don't look so much at the way in which you structure the physical object, but the way in which we structure the structures in the world, namely those that we study in mathematics. Yeah.
So this, the eidetic reduction, so am I right that you could do that without then being left with only the mathematical structure? So for instance, if you focus on redness, not a mathematical...
That's right. No, I think that's a very good question, because the examples I've given are from just standard mathematics. But Husserl, as you said, he thinks that there are lots of general features of reality that you could study by focusing on those features rather than on the objects out there. And that might be what you suggested, the redness, but also what is it to be a human? Because each one of us is a human being. But what is the structure that makes us human beings rather than this one and that one? So for you, I guess this would be a central topic, so that he mentions humanity in the sense of Menschlichkeit in German. What is it to be a person? That's one idea that you could study in phenomenology. And you could also study very social features. And there's a phenomenologist named Luckmann who has been writing a good deal on applications of phenomenology to social reality, they call it. And Husserl also, as I said earlier, suggests that you could have study of general features of space and so on, in which are not confined to geometry, but which we would now call topology. So he indicates branches of mathematics that haven't been fully developed, but which indicates how you could develop. And later on, of course, when you've got especially relativity theory, then there will be features of the structure of space and time in relativity that Husserl was very interested in. And there is a lot of correspondence between him and Hermann Weyl, who was... how many of you have heard of Hermann Weyl? Yeah. He was a mathematician, physicist, primarily a mathematician. And Hilbert, who was at Husserl's time in Göttingen, the main mathematician in the world, when he retired, he wanted Weyl to take over as his successor. But that was just at the time when the Nazis got power in Germany. And Weyl was not himself a Jew, but his wife was a Jew. So they emigrated to the United States, and Hermann Weyl became professor at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, where also Einstein was. So they had lots of chances to discuss these things between them. But there is Hermann Weyl's wife was studying with Husserl, so she studied phenomenology. And Hermann Weyl was interested enough in what his wife was doing, so that he went with his wife to Husserl's lectures. And there was, so he learned a good deal about phenomenology, and there was a correspondence between Weyl and Husserl. And you can see Weyl explains to Husserl his own ideas about relativity, time and space and so on, and Husserl responds in letters. So for those interested in that, there is a good deal of correspondence to look into. But so the eidetics that Husserl mostly interested were this more on the borderline towards mathematics and physics. But he does mention these things about what it is to be a human being and all kinds of features that many of you would be interested, for example, in psychology. Now I will skip a good deal of slides, and some of them I will come back after Easter, and you have a session. And since not all of you are focusing on philosophy and mathematics, I thought that we should now, in these first lectures, focus on other parts of phenomenology and then postpone philosophy and mathematics to next meeting after Easter. But this would be the point, if I gave a whole longer course on Husserl, this would be the point where we would go into philosophy and mathematics, because now we have talked about eidos and these general structures and the eidetic reduction. So now we'll just skip very quickly. This is something that I could include because we're going to talk about Quine in Lindeboe's lecture today. And Quine he talks about the reification of bodies, and that is something I'll say a little bit about. But also I wanted to mention to you this top passage. There's an interview, Quine is famous, and there were interviews with him all over, but I gave an interview down in Italy in 1994. And in that interview, he said that I recognized that Husserl and I, in very different ways, addressed some of the same things. So that there was a long development. This is towards the end of Quine's life. He had changed his views on many things, and he gradually discovered that the direction in which he had changed his view was very much in the direction of Husserl. And we'll see that when we go on to talk about Quine in the lectures today, Lindeboe's lectures. But in any case, one theme that Quine takes up is the notion of objects, bodies and so on, and that will be relevant both for general phenomenology and for philosophy mathematics. That is, Quine doesn't take simply the notion of a body, physical object, as given. There's a lot of structuring going on in our experience in the world as composed of objects, and how we divide the world up into objects and how we conceive of the objects, it will depend a lot on past experience. It's a matter of the way we structure the reality we live in. So that reification of bodies indicates already that Quine thinks that the notion of body is not simply given out there beforehand and then we passively receive this, but the whole idea of a body and the fact that we fuse things together and regard them as part of the same body, that is a reflection of this structuring activity. So I think that what Quine means that you and Husserl have, that this is late Quine, that at that time he has seen how much structuring goes into our conception of reality, and he has discovered that Husserl had the same thing, so that he had moved in the direction of Husserl. So that you might talk first about perceptual reification. That is what many philosophers end up with. They say that an object is something that preserves a kind of unity in perception. Things are connected with one another, they move together. Very often we talk about the rigid bodies, but the problem is that the notion of body is much more complicated. So he calls this perceptual verification, and he says maybe you even find out that animals, they recognize bodies from one time to another. But then there's something called full reification, or full reference, and that's the sophisticated stage where the identity of a body from one time to another can be queried or affirmed or conjectured or denied independently of exact resemblance. And this is very important in Husserl, and here Quine has the same thing, that you can say that two distinct objects are very, very similar. And one and the same object can look quite differently from one point of view to another, or at one time to another. If you keep pictures of yourself when you were babies, you'll see that you look quite differently now and then. But it's the same person. And that whole idea of identity of something through time, from different perspectives and all that, that is a rather fundamental idea in our whole notion of object. And that combines as a full reification, and you can recognize that you have full reification when you start being able to separate problems of similarity from problems of identity. So if you can use a diagram like this, and here you say that things are similar, more or less similar. And then you can say these are distinct and identical. And then you can have four possibilities. You can have things that are distinct but very similar. You can have things that are distinct and not singular, but unlike. Like. This is the nomistic, distinct things are. But then you can have identical objects. One, and then plural is not really right. It's the same object, and they are usually like, but it can be different, looked from different perspectives, different types, and so on. And you can have identical objects that are unlike. So if you master these four things, then you have an understanding of full reification. Then you are not simply depending on just perception, but full. But this is also in Husserl. Quine didn't get it from Husserl, but he has arrived at this kind of thing himself. So that this is a manuscript that he wrote, and it was not published in the beginning, but it has been published in a later volume. So it's not an article. But in any case, I picked these passages because they indicate how Quine is on to some of the same topics that we are dealing with in Husserl. And one of them has to do with how much structuring goes into the notion of an object. And with personal identity, that by itself will be a big topic. What is it that makes this the same person as that one? And what is it that makes twins that are very, very similar, still distinct persons? I can give you lots of examples. We have two sets of grandchildren who are twins, and one of them are identical twins, and when they were small, I couldn't see the difference between them. And therefore, when we were together with them, I always paid attention to some piece of clothing or something that made me to distinguish, because they were very depressed if I mixed up the names. For us, it would be rather strange for us to be mixed up with somebody else, and for these, they seem to lose their own sense of identity when we mix them up. And this is then part of the identity of persons. And I have a colleague at Stanford named John Perry, who has written a whole little book on the notion of personhood. What is it to be this person rather than that one? So these are typical topics from Husserl. He has done it independently, but Husserl pays a lot of attention to it. And now, these are issues played, these are Gödel, many other things. Gödel was very much inspired by Husserl, and we'll look at that later. In my view, Gödel is comparing Gödel's comments on Husserl with those that you find in some professional Husserl scholars. I think Gödel really seems to have a better understanding of some of these tricky points in Husserl than many of the ones who have spent their lives studying Husserl. So these will be things for next time. Yeah, that's Hermann Weyl. This goes for next time. Now this is something that Husserl talks a good deal about, evidence. It's a word that comes back again and again. He asks, how can you have evidence for something? And he says that he uses the word evidence for in a way that is similar to what is used in criminal courts. You know, often when philosophers and mathematicians talk about evidence, they think that's a perfect, can't be different, it's evident. But when Husserl uses the word evidence, it's not this absolute notion, but he says you have evidence then you have good reasons to believe that it's this way. But there's always a possibility that you could have gone wrong, overlooked something. And it's, so I think it's helpful to think of it the way you do in criminal courts. The two sides present evidence. It's called evidence in the court, but it doesn't make it evident, but it helps support the view that this person was guilty, for example. And you can present counter evidence, and it's up to the judge to weigh these pieces of evidence against one another and decide whether the person did it or not. So here Husserl points it out, they deviate from the customary use of the term evidence, which is, as a rule, is employed in cases which rigorous are those of adequate givenness on the one hand and of apodictic evidence on the other. Adequate evidence, Husserl distinguishes adequate and apodictic. Adequate evidence means that all your anticipations are fulfilled. There is nothing more to investigate. It's all adequate. So you really, there's nothing more to feel out about. And apodictic insight, that is the negation of what you have insight about would be contradictory. So apodictic insight is used in fields where you can have contradictions coming up. So that if some simple things in mathematics you could have apodictic insight about, for example, that 1 + 1 = 2, because if you assume there's something different, then you get into contradictions. But you cannot have, even in mathematics, you cannot have adequate evidence. For example, what do we know about the number 2? You know, 1 + 1 = 2, 3 - 1 = 2. But there are lots of things. For example, until recently, it was not known if you have this simple equation, 3 to the second + 4 to the second = 35. Put it down this way, 5 to the second. Here you have 3 integers, 3, 4, and 5. So that when they're taken to the second power, the sum of those matches the sum of that one. That is, there was a French mathematician, Fermat, about 400 years ago, who wondered about that. There are lots of examples where you have the second power. But Fermat says, could you get it if you have the third power? Is there some? Solution for that in integers for numbers. And Fermat tried and tried and couldn't find an example of it, but he wasn't able to prove. But he said that he had found a proof, but that proof was too complicated, that he didn't have room for it in the margin of this is a small book on what is called Diophantine equations. And then mathematicians have struggled and struggled for all these hundreds of years trying to find a higher exponent, or true that there is none. And Gauss, for example, one of the great mathematicians, he spent 7 years of his life and ended up saying that he can't find any proof, and he thought that Fermat must have been wrong. And then, a few years ago, a mathematician at Princeton find out that there are no higher exponents. 2 is the highest one. So this is a simple problem, and it's a number 2. Does it have that property or not? It's as simple an object as you could imagine, number 2. But still, it's transcendent because it's so much more that we don't know about it. It's just inexhaustible. And then Husserl also uses the word of evidence as self-giving. There's some anticipations you have, which are fulfilled when you have evidence, but to insist again and again that he uses the word evidence in such a way that it doesn't mean that it's indubitable. It's just, so I think it's helpful to think of what happens in a court when you read Husserl's words, evidence. Now we get Gödel on the same thing, and that comes next time. But now we get to the ego. We have these philosophers who were dualists. Descartes, Malebranche, Leibniz are three of very many famous dualists in the history of philosophy. But Husserl is a monist. He says that there's one person and there are aspects of this person. This is a key idea in all the areas where Husserl worked, that he is so concerned with aspects. You know, many people say two things. Husserl says, no, these are two aspects of the same. So that he uses this idea here, that you could have one and the same object, identicals, but it could be experienced from different points of view. It could have many different aspects. And for Husserl, then, he's a monist, and we as persons have both bodily aspects and we have mental aspect. And then it's a one self, it has several aspects. And now it's easy to understand these phrases that you find in Husserl, the empirical ego and the transcendental ego. Husserl wrote an article for the Encyclopedia Britannica, 1913 edition, a long article on phenomenology, and there he explains also the notion of the ego. And Heidegger, who was his, became his assistant, he suggested improvements in that article. And one thing that Heidegger tried to get Husserl to say, but didn't succeed, was that he said that Husserl seems to be have the idea that we have split personality. We have a transcendental ego and we have an empirical ego. So that Heidegger, even in his later writings, has really misunderstood this point in Husserl. When Husserl talks about the transcendental ego and the empirical ego, he's not talking about two different egos, as Descartes, for example, did. He talks about one ego, but two aspects of the same ego. So that notion of aspect is very helpful for understanding a lot of things in Husserl. And it fits in very well, of course, with the fact that there's all that structuring going on, so that when we experience an object, it depends on how we experience it, it depends on what structure we have, and we can experience it quite differently from one aspect to another. For example, Mount Everest has different names on the Tibetan side and the Nepal side, and it took a little while before they found out it was the same object. And Frege's example, the morning star and the evening star, which I used earlier, that is an example of one star having two aspects. And that's typical of the ego. So the ego is a little bit like the morning star, the evening star. It shows two aspects, but the point is that the ego shows one empirical aspect, which you find out about when you study the ego as an empirical object. When you look at yourself in the mirror, you have an empirical aspect of yourself. When you put into for an operation in the hospital, it's the empirical aspect of you that the doctor is then studying. But if you go to a psychologist or a psychiatrist, then it's the mental aspect of you. But it's still the same object. I think this seems very natural, and I think one reason that philosophers have started saying that we are two different things is that they haven't thought enough about the fact that all things have different aspects. And then we had this notion of a person, a human person, that in studying a person, there are different levels that we have to separate here. First, when we encounter the person, there are these acts that you observe, the person might say something. So some of these acts are speech acts. That word speech act is sometimes attributed to Austin, but in Oxford, but actually it's used by Husserl, and very many of Husserl's students developed complicated theories of speech acts, or complicated name. They are anticipating a lot of what has later been said about speech acts. So in any case, when we encounter one another, we have all these acts that we are carrying out of different kind, practical acts, speech acts, and so on. But so that's one feature of a person, all these acts. Then you have something that is also a feature of a person, and that is the propensity to act in certain ways. For example, if you are a carpenter, you might you can observe immediately how you deal with the carpentry tools, and that might tell you that this is a skilled carpenter, so that the skill that you have would be on a second order. The skill itself is manifested through what you have at the bottom level, through the acts, but by observing the acts you can come to see that this person has a certain skill. Carpentry can is a good bicyclist, you can do complicated sports. And we have mental skills, we can speak a language, and we have that skill even in periods when we don't open our minds. So that a skill is something that lasts a lot longer than the individual instantiation of that skill. So beliefs would be like a skill. It's something that you have, a property of yours, but you don't need to manifest it to the surrounding world all the time, but sometimes you say something that indicates what belief you have. And you might have desires that also sometimes manifest themselves through action or through words, but Husserl distinguishes the manifestation from the fact that you have these propensities. He calls them propensities, correspondingly in German. But then that is a third level of propensity, and that would be a propensity to change your skills, develop your skills, and so on. I think one example would be gullibility. There are persons who change their beliefs relatively easily. They don't need much evidence in order to change it. So you can get them to believe rather strange things by telling them a suitable story. Then they are called gullible. They are easily taken in without, because they don't seem to need much evidence in order for them to take on a certain view. And that's not having a belief, but it's the propensity to change beliefs in certain ways. And others can be skeptical. You know, you need a lot of evidence in order to change their view on something. So that's to be skeptical, to be gullible, are propensity at that second level. And kindness, it can be a person who's very warm-hearted, and that person very easily develops skills that are suitable for taking care of people in particular actions. That the warm-heartedness, the kindness, will be a kind of second-order skill. And then the next level, who's of course, that's the person. So that a person has some very permanent properties, these are the second order skills, and on the basis of those it gets second, first order skills, or first order propensities, and then on the basis of them they act, and we observe the acts and what they say and so on. So this is a kind of brief sketch of Husserl's view on the person, and I think that especially for those who want to go into applying phenomenology to psychology and things dealing with human subjects, it's useful to see this. And these propensities, they hold both for the empirical aspects and for the transcendental aspects of the person. So now we have looked then at, this was a kind of brief glimpse of Husserl's view on the person. At first it's a monist view, and that both for the empirical and for the transcendental aspect, you have these levels of propensities, and then you have the person as that which has all these propensities and levels of them. So then we have embodiment, which I haven't seen much about, but we did touch on it earlier. And I did mention Maurice Merleau-Ponty as a person who was very inspired by Husserl, and also actually did more work on this than Husserl had done. But I did mention how, unlike Heidegger, who was very close to Husserl, that translated into a deep-sounding terminology, and doesn't really give credit to Husserl. Merleau-Ponty, that's what I think we should all do. He thanks Husserl for the inspiration, he's grateful for having been able to read Husserl's manuscripts and all that, and then he thinks more about it and develops it further. And what Merleau-Ponty does is to focus a lot on habits and how these different properties that we looked at are shaped by what we do. And this is, of course, also important for ethics, because to be virtuous, for example, is to get into the habit of easily doing things that are right. When you are starting to try to be a moral actor, you have to think and say, now I really have to stand by it and do it. And once you've done it many times, it becomes more and more easy to be a good person. So that we get into these habits, and Husserl calls them habitualities, and he also calls them the sedimentations. It is something that is sedimented through our activity and remains there as properties, as propensities of us. And pairing we talked about earlier, how we always think. Then we have intersubjectivity, we experience the other person directly. So when I look at you, I see a person. I don't see a body, and then I ask myself, as Descartes did, is there some person behind there or something like that? So that we are really, this is instilled in us through sedimentation from the time we were babies, that gradually what becomes natural for us is to experience these people we meet as persons. And we would be very astonished if somebody makes a robot, which is like that it takes a little while before we discover that this was not a person. So the anticipations have to do with persons. And it's when something goes against those anticipations that we feel awkward. While for Descartes and many others, the anticipations have to do with the body. And then one carries out inferences to get to the person. It was the opposite. And also we see actions and not just movements. So when you reach up your hand for something, I take it to be an action indicating that you have a question or whatever. And I don't go through an act of reasoning and say, that hand went up, I wonder what can be behind that, and so on. So, and I think if you think about Husserl's whole view about the structuring taking place through sedimentation, then it's natural that what we're accustomed to doing is what brings about the structure. And then our experience of the other as a person, that gives us then Einfühlung. That is, we come to share that person's feelings. Because experiencing a person is not just like experiencing a body. There's much, much more to a person than the body. In fact, from ourselves, we know that there's much, much more to us. And we automatically transfer that to experience of others. We experience them as by caring as very similar in many ways to us, not just bodily. And then some experience and the other as a subject with a certain perspective on the common world. So for the human, for the Husserlian way of looking at a person and man, it's important that all of these features are transferred from our experience of ourselves to the experience of the other. And it's not through inference, but it just is that way that we structure the other person. And we have a perspective of our common world And we experience the others as having a perspective. And the first little step in that perspective would of course be that we think that persons see what is in front of them and not what is in the back. Even small babies very quickly learn to see that they can play hide and seek, they hide behind something and they don't expect you to see through that thick tree, for example. So very, very early we transfer this to others. So that we come to experience the other as a subject with its own perspective. So we know, we understand others and experience others on the basis of pairing with ourselves. It's only when things happen that don't fit in with the pairing that we are having to adjust. That we might, I talked a little bit last time about finding out that another person isn't able to see, is blind, or hears very badly, or has some other physical or mental deviation from us. And note that those deviations aren't always negative. It's not that we are the way we are, we are the perfect perfection of it, and then all deviations are bad. Of course, since we are all seeing, I've used this example of being blind as being defective on that. But not all deviations are defects. You can be good at a sport, but you see somebody is even better. And you could learn by observing the movements and so on. A lot of training takes place that way. And Husserl is also saying a good deal about how sport training is not just a matter of learning how to use your muscles, but it's also imitating. So there are lots of bodily features that are more natural and better learned through imitation than through thinking. For example, if you want to become a good high jumper, you don't sit down and learn about your muscles and say you should first use that one and then this one and then that one. That you start imitating the movements without having to know a lot of anatomy before you do it. Sometimes anatomy might help, but that's not how to practice to do training. So in that way we also perform these mutual adjustments. We see that we are different in many, many ways. So initially we started out from ourselves, and then found that some others deviated a little bit from what we might have done in that situation, and that deviations might be something we look upon as handicap, or negative, or positive. And we then make these mutual adjustments and find out sometimes that we might be a little bit defective in some ways, and we might get rid of these defects by practice and so on. It happens that you meet a person who's just so aware of your needs and of other people's needs in general, always very helpful and so on, and you might not even observe that that person needs help. And that's the first step then, at least noticing what this very helpful person is doing. Noticing, well, there was really somebody needed help there. Maybe I should also look for people who need help and try to train myself to help them. So that these attitudes and so on can be taken over by others. And through these adjustments, we can come to see that certain habits are better, even from an ethical point of view, than certain other habits. Aristotle discusses virtues versus vices. Both virtue and vice will be habits, but a virtue is a good habit, and a vice is a bad habit. And Aristotle had the discussions of how we can improve our habits and become virtuous. You become virtuous by again and again doing the acts that a virtuous person will do. So in the beginning it costs effort, and then gradually it becomes more and more natural to you. And that holds not only but for the action, but also for your ability to empathize with the person, that is to understand the person's needs what causes suffering, what is very bad for the person, what is good. And that is then, of course, the beginnings of ethics. And then, this is something I mentioned briefly, but earlier, that was, of course, phenomenology is focusing very much on subjectivity. It's all the way about how we structure things and so on, in all realms. And but then, if you read his early work on subjectivity, very many philosophers get so impressed by it that they carry out these analyses of subjectivity. And Husserl himself, already in 1900, in the first volume of Logical Investigations, he argued against subjectivity. And he then said that we should think that it's subjective and relative. One of the psychologists inspired by Husserl was Lyme. I don't know if you heard of him. He was a French psychologist. And he claimed that we all experience the world in different ways. And he took over this emphasis on subjectivity from Husserl. And then he says that some people experience it in a way which other people dislike. And if the others are many enough, and the ones who have that propensity are few enough, they will put you into an asylum. But who ends up in the asylum? It depends simply on majority. If those who now sit in asylums have been in majority, then it would be the opposite way. So for him, it's important for him not to talk about mental illness or anything like that. It's simply a matter of counting votes. And Husserl, of course, he didn't experience lying. Lying wrote these things after Husserl's death. That he was inspired by Husserl because people got very inspired by what we talked about the way we structure things and so on. And they can give very convincing examples of how we structure and how certain kinds of mental, what we call mental illness, is just another way of structuring things.
And then Foucault?
What?
Foucault?
Foucault is not quite as extreme as lying. But
he's less extreme. He's less extreme than lying.
Less extreme than lying, yeah. But Foucault is, of course, much better known. And Foucault also emphasizes structuring quite a lot. But he's not like... he has some ideas a little bit like it when it comes to treatment in mental hospitals and things like that. And Foucault also had ideas about intellectual development of a culture. You see, we are structuring things, that he takes over from Husserl, and we therefore anticipate all the time that this is how things are. And this comes to color our vision of the world, these anticipations. And then Foucault says that sometimes the structuring reaches a certain point where there's not much of an option except to tip over to another way of structuring it. And he thinks of intellectual history like that. There are these breaks. And Foucault's idea is that these important breaks in science and intellectual history are not so much a product of one genius, but there is something in the structure that has reached a point where that change will be natural. So that suddenly, at one point, a lot of scientists agree pretty much on one way of looking at things, and they might work and try to find solutions to problems they have. And then somebody comes up with a new idea, and we start looking at things quite differently. Relativity theory would be such an example. Einstein started looking at time and space differently. And Foucault says that this happens in all realms, and that we have a tendency to give one person credit for that. But it has much more to do with the situation in the science having developed to a certain stage where a crisis would not naturally come. And then it might happen that many people could have gotten the same idea, but often one gets it first and then he gets the credit. And Foucault then gives various examples in some of his books of such breaks. So the idea is if things come up to the point, and then there's a sudden break, and that break could then take place many different places independently of one another, indicating that it's not one person produced the break, but that there is a structure in that field which reaches a point where it will naturally be needed, and another way of looking at it was needed. And I had a colleague at Stanford, he's still alive, but he's now in Canada, Ian Hackey. And he and I gave a course at Stanford on French, contemporary French philosophy. And he had then finished the manuscript for a big book on Foucault. He admired Foucault. And so he was going to give the lecture on Foucault, and I was going to give lectures on Sartre and Merleau-Ponty and these other people. And when we came to Foucault, then what happens with Foucault is very impressive, because when you read his writings, he has been around to libraries and archives all around, and he quotes from some obscure manuscript someplace where you have a certain view, and another place, same time, some very similar view in some other manuscripts. And then 10 years later, we can find in archives manuscripts that show that now a big transformation has taken place. And that happens also in many different places, and there's no connection. People haven't talked to one another. It's just there being some kind of stage that makes that break natural. That seems to be good and interesting. But what happened was that, you know, Foucault gives these very striking passages. And we started looking at the sources. And it turned out that Foucault, there are these quotes in the text, that Foucault left out a good deal of words that made it messy. It was not so clear that I had that view earlier, nor was it so clear that this other view was there. He just kept those parts that fit very well in with his idea of break. And left out without dots, at least, you know, sometimes you can in a paper give a quotation which is too long and you put some dots to indicate that something is missing. But the point was that what was missing in Foucault were also crucial parts. So it would not have been very striking if you had given it in full. But it didn't put in dots, so it sounded very striking, as if this really just confirmed his view very clearly. And then Hacking got so disappointed, and he asked me into his office, and there he took that big 400 pages of manuscript on Foucault, held it above his waste basket and tore it upon, down into the waste basket. So he never wrote that book on Foucault. But he keeps on admiring Foucault. He thinks that there are some important insights. And Hacking himself has written a book which is cutting out this Foucault idea. But he does it, it's called The Immersion of Probability. And if you are interested in probability calculus, this is an interesting book to read, because it there shows that in many different parts of the world people were thinking about probability in a certain way. And then within a span of about 10 years there was a new conception of probability coming, which manifested itself independently in different places. So you had authors in Italy, in France, in Germany, who at about the same time started thinking differently about probability, different notion of probability. And they could show that they had not heard about one another. That is just the Foucault idea, but Hacking did it properly. he really quotes properly from these passages, and I think that therefore Hacking is a better model than Foucault, but he was inspired by Foucault. He wrote the book because he agreed with Foucault that there are these breaks. So So in any case, this then also shows that this really does show that we have this structuring going on, and that there might be a case where this structuring naturally leads to a kind of break. You can't get any further with that structuring, and then you find a new way of looking at it. And then, although there is structuring going on, so that there is subjectivity going on, there are two important features that have been dropped by these people who are becoming extreme relativists. One is that we are not structuring the world in isolation. I talked about how even they gradually adapt. So we adapt an intersubjective perspective. So a blind person doesn't think of the world as being invisible. He thinks of the world as being visible, but that he or she simply doesn't have the ability to see it. And that happens in lots of fields. And it's very interesting when you go into less obvious cases and who's in a detailed analysis of this kind of adaptations that we make. Then the adaptations are such that we also see that there is a notion of objectivity. Even when we adapt to ourselves gradually through that process of adaptation, we see that it's not just a matter of, for example, the majority we have. It could be that we see that some few people seem to have, for example, particularly good eyesight. They notice things that others don't notice, and we adjust to them. We listen to them and adjust our view. So that there's an idea that a person who has a particular competence in something will be one whom we regard as more qualified as we are for judging that sort of things. And this is what we think of that in scholarship, that somebody has worked intensively on something and really penetrated into it might be a better judge than some others. But it holds in all realms, for example. And in the paper Husserl, Hilary Putnam at Harvard, he said that he doesn't know so much about botany. So when he walks in the forest, he's not able to see the difference between elms and beeches. But he has a friend who is a botanist, and he can tell him that's an elm and that's a beech. And he trusts his friend. And he knows that there are only a few people in the world who have the kind of competence, so that hundreds of his friends like him cannot distinguish. But that doesn't mean that you take a boat and then say that since 50% or more say that it's the same kind of tree, then that is the same kind. No. So the idea that you can be better qualified to judge on something, and Husserl goes into the epistemic processes by whereby you get better qualified to judge. So you get a notion of objectivity, which is tied in with this development of competence. And you have to have reasons for thinking that this person is more competent than you are. Maybe you have been living together and you know that this person is like cooking. Somebody might be better qualified as producing good food than others, and you can gradually find out who they are, and they get some kind of response that you defer to them, and that word defer indicates a little bit what they're after. And that's why Husserl says that we are starting from subjectivity, then we make all these adjustments and get intersubjectivity, and then by in intersubjectivity, not just counting heads, like lying, so that we decide who are going to be in the mental hospitals, we just count heads, and the majority wins. They stay outside, and the minority stays inside. It's not that way it happens, but from intersubjectivity we get objectivity because of these relatively complicated methods of deference and things like that. So Husserl even wrote the first volume of the Logical Investigations that he wrote in 1900. That is a criticism, very thorough criticism on relativism. And it's partly criticism because Husserl himself wrote in 1892 this book, Philosophy of Arithmetic, where he argued for relativism. And then Frege criticized that book in 1894. And Frege gave arguments against Husserl's position. And those arguments are repeated by Husserl in the first volume. But Frege wrote only this review. But Husserl, in this first volume of the Logical Investigations, he carries out these arguments in great detail. And he's often given credit for putting an end to relativism. But as I said, there is no... still having a deal of people are so impressed by his emphasis on subjectivity and structure and so on that they have overlooked and not probably read what they had to say about objectivity. Yeah, this is a slightly different talk. I said, okay, that we do it without the break. It's because then we should have time to eat before Einstein starts his thing. But in any case, there's something that is very conservative and which I haven't touched on yet, and that is that we have an experience of the world as being real. We distinguish between perception, for example, and imagination, and also perception and memory. I can remember a person and I can meet the person, but there's something different in the act. And in perception we have that feeling that this person is really there. But when we imagine or remember, then the object is not really there. And Husserl is interested in finding out why, how can it happen that we regard something as real and something else as imagined or remembered. And he says that it has to do with this thing here, that we are senses experience, that our senses are affected. It's very important in perception. You can imagine a horse as much as you want to, but you can sense it in here. And so sensuous perception is a key to our notion of reality, because you remember when I talked about the acts, I said that they have a noema, and that in that noema there is a thetic component. It is that differentiates acts of perception from acts of imagination and so on. And that thetic component is what we're now focusing on. And that thetic component has to do with our body being affected by this object. And that then is what Husserl looks more into. And now this passage could have been taken from Husserl. Sensuous vividness or pungency is then the vital factor in reality. But it's not Husserl, it's from William James in The Principle of Psychology, so from 1893. And you might wonder, is Husserl one who just steals ideas from others? And he's not. He was very, very impressed by James and gives a lot of credit to James. How many of you have read James' Principles of Psychology? You have looked at it?
I've read the book. I've read it.
Yeah, because it's a very, very fine book, I think. And James wrote very well. And Husserl, I told you that Husserl studied mathematics, got his PhD, then started as assistant to Weierstrass. But then Weierstrass became seriously ill and couldn't use an assistant anymore. And then Husserl decided to go into philosophy, went to Brentano, studied with him, and then went on and studied phenomenology for several more years. And shortly after he had decided to go into philosophy, he read William James' Principles of Psychology. And then he thought that James has done exactly what I wanted to do when I decided to leave mathematics to go into philosophy. I wanted to study these phenomena, because some of that he had learned already from Brad Powell. But now James has already done it. So he thought maybe I should go back to math again. But then he thought more about it. And there's a little more to do in philosophy than what James has done. But you will find lots of ideas from James in Husserl. And this is one of them.
What would Husserl say about delusions, for example? So experiences that aren't real but that feel very real.
Yeah. Yes, if you have an illusion or a delusion, then you structure things as if you perceive them. But then, normally, after a while, you will discover that not everything in your sensory experience goes the way it should if this was a real object. So you could even hallucinate something, and then when you get close enough, you hallucinate a sword, and then you put your hand through it, something like that. And this one interesting, you see this movie about Nash, the economist who won a Nobel Prize in economics. He was a favorite for the Nobel Prize for many years, but he was regarded as insane. They thought he couldn't really, he had to be protected in a desk. But he had these very beautiful contributions to economics. But then finally he was healthy enough to go. And one way in which he was healthy enough, you know, he was seriously mentally ill, and he had hallucinations. But being a very rational person, when he hallucinates something, and then he asked somebody, "Do you see that elephant?" I said, "No." Then he said, "That's a hallucination." So he used his subjectivity as a way of diagnosing whether he was hallucinating or not. And that helped him a little bit. But in any case, that would be a case where some of the experience was like perception, that there was something else. In some cases, it could be that you go close enough and discover that it doesn't feel the way it should. But in this case, he used the intersubjectivity criterion. If I stand here and look at that elephant and this person stands beside me, that person, unless he's blind, would also see that elephant. He sees that person is blind, but he doesn't see an elephant, so consequently, there is no elephant. So that's how you can use perception as a criterion for reality, but it has to be it has to be reliable perception, and there will be ways of deciding that this wasn't reliable. But you're quite right that the fact that we have the sensory experience doesn't suffice. It has to be that the experience continues the way we anticipate, and also that intersubjectivity will be a help. And then Husserl uses the word life world, and the first thing people think about when they hear about Husserl is life world. That's the one notion in Husserl that has become popular, especially in the social sciences, when they're studying the life world. And the life world is then the world in which we find ourselves living together with others, and which is structured to this big structure and activity that we're carrying out. And all our practice, theoretical and exotheoretical, takes place within this life world. So that it's always a necessary field of actual or possible praxis. And what is then this life world? Well, it's the life world in which we live. But remember that for Husserl that means that there's a lot of structuring that has taken place. It's not just the physical world out there that affects us through electromagnetic waves. You remember when I talked about perception at the very beginning, I gave this picture of Aristotle, where you have the object that affects us. So perception is reception. But what is new in Husserl is that perception involves a lot of activity or active structuring. And that is then the life world is then this very heavily structured world, but we are not aware of the structuring. Remember, for Husserl, most of the things in our life go on without our awareness. So we experience the world as something that is just there, and we have the experience that Aristotle felt that we had. Then we perceive, we receive impression from the outside. We are not normally aware of all that structuring that we are going on. That structuring is hidden to us, and that structuring is then uncovered in the transcendental reduction. So part of the point of the transcendental reduction is to make us aware of the structuring and not just take the world as simply being there and impinging upon us causally. So it's always necessarily there. To live is always to live in certainty of the world. That is, to live is always to live in a world that we regard as independent of us, and we are not aware of how we actually structure that world. Then we come to ethics. And here Husserl says that what is the source of these ethical concepts that we regard something as right, something as wrong, and so on. And then he says that they are acts of sentiment. So that our ethic distinction between what is right and what is wrong, and values and so on, have to do with sentiments, not so much with reason. Very many philosophers think that you have these, like Spinoza worked out this whole schism, ethics as an axiomatic system. You find Kant also focusing a lot on the categorical imperative, so there is some kind of attempt to base ethics on reason and argument from the very beginning. But Husserl says that it's sentiments, and he calls it acts of sentiment, that will be acts where you are having sentiments in connection with that act. For example, if you hurt somebody, you have an act of sentiment in recognizing that this is hurtful, painful. And that act of sentiment lies there at the bottom of ethics. So he's doing something that not many people found very popular at that time. We're trying to base ethics on sentiment rather than on reason. Reason plays a role, as we shall see, but the basis is sentiment. Without sentiments, there wouldn't be any ethics. So that if you didn't have sympathy with some people or suffering and so on, there wouldn't be ethics at all. So that if you just do things because you have figured out that according to such and such moral principles, that's what you should do, then you are not really properly acting morally, that you, if what you do might happen to be moral. And then so this acts of sentiment are evidence for values, and how can then the validity of ought be recognized? These are quotations from Husserl, and even when I try to do it a little better, these are my translations because they are from the German manuscript. It's hard to make it very straightforward and simple English without missing a few things in the text. So that there are some acts of sentiment which are the basis for our judgments of rightness and wrongness of acts. And those sentiments have very much to do with putting yourself in the other person's place. You know?
It sounds quite a lot like Hume.
It's like Hume, and I'll show you in a moment. That's very good. There you have it. So that was anticipating what is coming. And that's David Hume. But now look at what Hume says. The strength of our feelings is no reliable measure of the rightness or wrongness of our acts. So Hume and Husserl gives credit to Hume a lot. Husserl thinks that Hume had lots of insights that Kant really had missed. And actually, he thinks that you need something more than just what Hume tells us, partly in order to, because the strength of a feeling is no reliable measure of the rightness or wrongness. So you can't say just right, this is right and this is wrong, because the feelings are so strong. And Husserl overcomes that problem. You can say, Hume, as you pointed out, paid a lot of attention to sentiments as a basis of ethics, but he had some qualms because the strength of our sentiments, our feelings, are no good measure for whether it's wrong, or how wrong or right it could be, and very often we have to weigh one thing against another. So, sentiments then, these are from manuscript, that is, there appeals to Hume, and not just to Hume, but also to some other, that same group of Scottish philosophers. And he agrees with them that one who is sentiment blind, in the way we can be color blind, then everything moral loses its content. And there can be no talk of good and bad, and one abstracts for sentiments. So there are lots of passages like this. And not as if we can accept, there you have Hume, the content of his argumentation in its entirety. But one thing it makes certain, one thing is thereby completely evident, sentiment is essentially involved in the coming about of ethical distinctions. It's a little bit related to the appeal to the golden rule. You say, don't do to others what you don't do to you. There you have to put yourself in the position of the one who is affected, and then try to see what kind of feeling you can have. So that feelings are the foundations of ethics. Golden rule is one example. I think that if you look at the history of ethics, the golden rule was the first thing to come out. I had a colleague at Stanford who was a specialist on early Chinese philosophy. His name was Nibison. He died a couple of months ago, but he was 91. So, in any case, he was able to interpret some of the oldest inscriptions there are in the world. You know, parchment and so on doesn't stay on very long, it dissolves. But these are inscriptions about 6,000 years old, and bone carving in China. And they saw these bones and all these carvings, but they had great troubles interpreting what was in them. And he found out that they are inscriptions of the golden rule, again and again. And that was what first people who could write found so important, that they wanted to write it down, the golden rule. And then you have Adam Smith and Husserl, who both were very strongly impressed by Hume and agreed on the role of sentiments. They both felt there was something missing. There is something in Hume which doesn't pay enough attention to the perspective you have relative to the person with whom you feel sentiment. So that there's a kind of relativism that Hume struggles with and that they try to overcome. And Christel Fricke, who is here, she is an expert on Adam Smith, and we agreed that we should try to have a meeting where we compare and contrast Adam Smith and Husserl. And there's a book on the shelf there which is the proceedings from that meeting, Adam Smith and Husserl. So what is remarkable is that both of them took Hume as their source of inspiration, that they felt that something was missing, and both of them single out the same kind of things that they needed to supplement you to give this in. And then Husserl comes with subjectivity, intersubjectivity and objectivity, some of these things that we talked briefly about. Important is to bring in all perspectives. We have to focus on the handicapped, the unborn, the later generations, and then put ourselves in the position of the person who is this act is affecting, and ask what would we experience if we were in that position. And then we have a teaching ethics trained ability to put yourself in the other's place. That's to be. So it's learned, especially children could learn ethics by just being trained to always think about how this affects others, and not by teaching Kant's second critique. You can look upon this Kant's second critique as a reflection on the kind of structures and interconnections you have here, but the basis for it all would be Hume, or would be these sentiments that we have. Thank you. So next time and after Easter, we will focus a lot on the applications of those two mathematics, and we bring in a good deal of Gödel, because Gödel, when he discovered Husserl in 1969, he became so impressed that Husserl had really thought through very, very clearly things that Gödel had thought about, and then he had formulated his own view. That with Husserl, he saw how all these things were fit together into a very coherent and embracing philosophical position. So you're welcome. It will not be very technical, but it will be focusing on something that I go off in relation to mathematics. Yeah. And you have enough of a break to have a fight before you listen to us anymore. Any questions?
I had a question about the last thing you said about that you have to place yourself in the perspectives of everyone involved.
Yeah.
Did he have any requirements on whom can be the sort of the subjects that you place yourself in? For example, when you consider unborn babies, some people will say that, well, that's not the subject.
Yeah.
If you talk about animals, etc. So did he have any restrictions in that?
No. So that the unborn baby would be a very good problem, because of course unborn babies don't have the same kind of black and white as we have. They don't have the same sensory system in the beginning and so on. So that what you then have to do, one kind of step would be that if a baby is conceived, and they see that the mother or the parents consider aborting the baby, then the emotions evoked will not be so strong at the early stage, even if you could see the baby, because at the early stage it's just a few cells. But the further along in the development the baby has come, the more will it emotionally affect us, and that's why, you know, there have been, you can start seeing fingers, and you can see eyes develop. And Husserl is very concerned with how certain features of human beings that are sort of better to build up this kind of sentiment that is the basis of ethics. If you have eye contact, if your fingers and eyes tend to be particularly connected with this kind of moral sentiment. And therefore, women are going to think of considering abortion, they would avoid any detailed knowledge of the fetus. And certainly an indication that their own fetus is starting to develop eyes and fingers and so on. And that happens relatively early. So in a way, one has to close oneself off from certain impressions, otherwise one is affected and feels that it's wrong. So that Husserl is very concerned with what are the blocks that prevent us from properly seeing things. And of course in a society there will be blocks, we try to live in such a way that we don't see these beggars. You have the same discussion now about beggars. We don't want to be reminded that there are people who are suffering and so on. In the case of beggars, people say, well, they should get a job, but in any case, And then, so simply, the fact that you do start to get these feelings that Husserl talks about relatively early, if you know enough about it. There's this Swedish photographer who specialized in photographing fetuses, so you can see how early these things come. And of course, after the birth, if the fetus is not aborted, then you have that little child there is a unique person. Every person is a unique thing. And that unique person would not have been born if you had cut it off. And now you feel that for that person, it certainly is very important that that person lives. So there would be that kind of considerations that which let's discuss abortion, but that seems to be a very applying this to one of these ethical cases that are much discussed. And if you follow through his reflections on strength of emotions and so on, the emotions that guide to opposite on this, then it seems as if abortion, even at a very early stage, would be unethical. So therefore, of course, society should try to find other solutions. Of course, earlier, if the mother got a baby, there would be hardly help for the mother to get. It would be a big, big burden in many ways. Now at least that burden isn't there. And now I think it happened because they don't know, they don't want others to know that they have a baby without being married or something like that. Or sometimes it would be a married couple who are in economic difficulties, or the boyfriend continuing the jobs or whatever. But in any case, the kind of thought experiment that I mentioned would be carried out, getting as close a contact to that person as possible is very important. And the same holds in so many other fields. For example, these buildings were built in the 60s. And 10 years ago, we went to a lot of expense to make the wheelchair accessible. I don't know why we did that from the beginning. It would have cost very little. The problem is that nobody thought about it. I think that one should really, in every building committee, have somebody who is handicapped, people with different kinds of handicaps, to make sure that their part of you is coming into the consideration. They're often forgotten. People think about their own experience, but haven't really emphasized enough to bring in these others. So that's clear in Husserl, that you should bring in every relevant perspective. So the idea of perspective is important. And for ethics, everybody who is affected should be put in. So that there could be certain rules that you could use in deciding what to do, what is the right thing to do. The first thing is that you have alternatives. You should think, what are the alternatives? Often one gets hooked on just one alternative and sees difficulties and so on and rejects it, but often the modification of that alternative might give you the best solution. But for each alternative, you then ask, if I do this, who will then be affected by it? And then, how will those who are affected by it experience what happens? And not just experience it just now, but maybe later in life, how will it be for them? And then if you find out that the first alternative you thought of was just awful for some people, often that might give you an idea of how to modify it, so you get something where the outcome is more acceptable.